is not what it appears to be. Joining me on the program is G. Edward Griffin. He's the author of The Creature from Jekyll Island, which has just been re-released and updated in its fifth edition. And Mr. Griffin, I want to start out in your chapter, Protectors of the Public. In your previous editions, you talked about the bailouts of Penn Central, Continental Illinois, Chrysler. But there's a part of the subprime meltdown that investors weren't aware of, and it's the way the whole system works. And that is, from a banking perspective, the banks went and made these reckless loans, no documentation. And they did that because in the background, in the back of their minds, they always felt, you know what, we've got the Fed. If we get into trouble, they'll bail us out. So let's begin with what encouraged them to go out and make these reckless loans.
Well, Jim, I think you described it pretty well. In the insurance business, you know, that's what they call a moral hazard. When there is no real risk involved because of one reason or another, if there's no risk, then people are willing to do things knowing that they're going to be bailed out. That's the old joke about, you know, burning down the restaurant because you're only making $50,000 a year, but if you burn down your restaurant and make it look like an accident, you've got the insurance can collect $5 million. So, you know, that's moral hazard. And there's moral hazard built right into the banking system ever since the Federal Reserve System was created. And that was part of the plan. They knew from the very beginning that if they could partner with the federal government that, and then go through the appearance of being regulated by the federal government, which was more of a mirage than anything else. Actually, it was more the other way around. The banks eventually developed so much power over the government that it seemed like they were the regulators and the government were the ones being regulated. But anyway, that's another issue. Yeah, they knew from the beginning that as long as they were partnered, that somewhere down the line, if they ever got into trouble, as you said, that they would be bailed out with taxpayers' money. And that's what I wrote about when I published this book way back in 1994. And it had already happened by that time on numerous occasions, but I was able to see that this mechanism was very firmly entrenched and it was gaining momentum. And I could see that in the future, which has now come to pass, that the bailout mechanism was going to just continue to go and there would be much more of it and much more devastating effects in the economy. And the average bloke out there, the average guy that, you know, that I consider myself to be part of that group, the average public, they don't know anything about that. I didn't know anything about that till I decided some years ago to make it an object of my investigation. Most people don't have the time for that. I'm fortunate because that's my business. I can decide I'm going to investigate something, and I can take out months or years if necessary. But the average person on the street, he doesn't have time for that. He's got to make a living. He's got his own profession. He's got his own job. He's got his family to worry about and so forth. So the average person pretty well just takes what they hear on the radio or on the television. So I guess that's what's happening, and they never have an opportunity to question it. But the bottom line, Jim, as you so well know, is that this whole banking cartel called the Federal Reserve System is nothing but a system of legalized plunder of the American taxpayer. And it's certainly, it should be more obvious nowadays, but apparently it's not. People are upset, but they still don't understand what's going on. They want something to happen, but they don't know what, and they turn to the very same people that have pulled the scam on them in the past, and those are the people they're asking for solutions. So you know right from that they really don't understand what's going on.
Well, you know, everybody remembers hearing about the TARP bailout of $700 billion, but as you talk in your book, by the end of 2008, the bailout of the financial service industry in the Bush administration alone had reached $7 trillion. Now, there's an interesting comment that you made. In the fall of 2008, after they let Lehman go under, then you saw a series of dominoes, Merrill Lynch being one of them. Bank of America agreed to buy the ailing firm for $50 billion, a strange offer considering that Bank of America itself received $25 billion in the bailout.
Yes.
And then once the bank found out how bad the losses were, they tried to bail out. And Ken Lewis at that time wanted to bail out, and he got a call from Hank Paulson. Let's talk about what happened and how this bailout went through.
Well, sure. Yeah, as you said, Lewis decided that it was not a good deal for the Bank of America to acquire Merrill Lynch because they had so many debts that they didn't know about originally. It was all buried in the books, but by the time their accountants got in there and really looked into the books, they realized that there was a tremendous liability and that they didn't think they could survive it. So the board of directors at B of A, under the guidance of Lewis, said, well, we can't go through with this. Well, then he got a call from the Treasury Secretary Paulson and made what you might call a demand of Lewis. He said, no, you have to buy Merrill Lynch. You just have to do it. And Lewis said, well, Mr. Paulson, that's easy for you to say, but we cannot pick up the losses. It would surely sink our little ship. We don't have to come back to the government again and ask for another billion or $5 billion or $100 billion, and that's what we would have to do. And Paulson said, look, I have been requested by Mr. Bernanke, the chairman of the Federal Reserve System, to tell you that you must buy Merrill Lynch because we do not want it to fold. And we will cover you. We will make sure that you will not lose anything. If you have these losses, we'll provide the money to you in one way or another, or we'll give it to you as a credit. We'll make sure that you do not lose on this deal. And Lewis, and by the way, we know this because Lewis testified. He made this public statement. He almost word for word what I'm saying. And Lewis said, well, that changes everything, Mr. Bernanke. I don't know whether that's a good thing or not for the American people, but if you're going to guarantee it, I guess we have to reconsider it. It would certainly be good for Bank of America. But would you put that in writing so, you know, I can take it to the board of directors? And here was the thing that we're leading up to. Paulson said no, he would never put it in writing, he said, because, and this is his words, Paulson's words, he said, that would be a disclosable event, and we do not want a disclosable event, end quote. Well, I don't know if that strikes most people as hard as it strikes me, but when you just think about that statement, this is typical of what goes on in government and banking more and more. People make deals, under-the-table deals, or behind-closed-doors deals, and they don't want anything in writing so they can deny it, so they can say, that's not true. They can say, oh, it's just a conspiracy theory, you know, and all of that sort of thing. In other words, we do not have a transparent government, and certainly when it relates to banking, we don't have any transparency at all. Everything is a non-disclosable event. And that becomes important a year or so later when these banks and the Treasury Secretary are telling the American people that everything has worked out just fine. Look, the banks are paying back their loans. General Motors is paying back its loans. They're floating stock and so forth, and they're selling stock. And the old free enterprise capitalist system is kicking in. And isn't it a good thing we did this? And you know what? That's all just smoke and mirrors. Can I prove it? No, because it's a non-disclosable event, you see. There's nothing in writing, but we know just by looking at the balance sheets of these corporations and these banks, they are not making enough money, enough profit to pay back those huge, huge bailouts. They just aren't making it. In fact, in most cases, they're continuing to dip into the muck. So where is the money coming from? Well, in my view, it's a non-disclosable event. The money is coming from a deal, a promise made by the Federal Reserve System to these banks and corporations that they will provide the money. In other words, they will make new loans or new bailouts off the record that nobody knows about in order for them to publicly pay off the old bailouts and make them all look good. And that, in a nutshell, is the game that's being played as we speak.
I want to come back to that for a moment, but, I mean, you talk about in your book this sort of fusion that we see between the banking cartel, the government, the Federal Reserve, and Henry Paulson epitomized that. First of all, he was the former head of Goldman Sachs. He arranged the sale of Bear Stearns to J.P. Morgan Chase. He allowed Lehman Brothers to collapse, forced the absorption of Merrill Lynch into Bank of America. So at the end of the day, you only had two giants left standing, both Goldman and Morgan. Now I want to move on to this repayment. I want to get into more detail because we saw the press conferences. The president said, you know, the taxpayers made a return on their investment. And when it came to, for example, December 2009, Bank of America announced it repaid its $45 billion loan from the Treasury. However, if you look at the examination act, the source of the money was said to be cash reserves in the sale of new stock. Well, number one, they didn't sell enough new stock. And if you look at their cash reserves, they had loans that were continuing to go sour. Defaults had tripled from the first quarter to the third. Bad loans were up 15%. So how can a company that is losing money, has bigger write-offs, loan loss reserves are increasing and they tripled, and all of a sudden, magically, they come up with $45 billion?
Well, of course, it's impossible. So the question is, where is the money coming from and what channel? We know where it's coming from. It's coming from you and from me. It's coming from the taxpayers. But what is the channel through which it is being flowed? And I suspect that it's coming through the Federal Reserve as a form of a grant or a credit guarantee so that some of the large investment funds can buy this stock. Or the evidence is beginning to percolate out now that perhaps the Federal Reserve itself is buying the stock. There's really nothing that stops it from doing that if it wants to. And, you know, judging by the record of these, the word comes to mind, crooks. Judging by the record of these people, there's nothing to give you any assurance that that's not what they're doing. They're just probably buying the stocks of General Motors and these banks themselves and creating the money out of nothing, which means it's going to come from the taxpayers through inflation. But meanwhile, they can get on television and crow about how wonderful it was and how wise they were and what great decisions those were. But meanwhile, you know, the big black birds are still up there flying and they haven't come home to roost yet.
And another example of this is we saw the bailout of the automobile companies. The figures for GM were astronomical. But we had press conferences like the repayment of the loans for Bank of America. You had General Motors that was repaying the government. But if you look closely, they were repaying the first loans with the second loans that they were getting. In other words, they weren't repaying the taxpayers or the government for money that they were making selling cars.
That's the point, exactly. They're just new loans for old, and you know the new loans had to be bigger than the old, so the problem is just, it's not solved, it's postponed, put off a little bit more into the future, and it grows.
And you bring up a point, and I want to tie this into what I think is the next round in this kind of scheme. And you point out that what the government funds, it controls, and what it controls, it owns. And there was a speech that Tim Geithner made that he said he's prepared to oust any CEO of any bank that received a bailout if he doesn't run the bank correctly. Now, the states in this country, many of them are running huge, monstrous deficits. My own state of California, our own state being one of them. Now, if the federal government starts bailing out the states, do the states, in essence, lose their sovereignty? Because going back to your statement, what the government funds, it controls, and what it controls, it effectively owns.
Well, yes, I think that's an obvious thing if you just spend a moment or two contemplating that. The states, and increasingly now even the counties and cities in this country, are all bankrupt. Not all of them, but increasingly bankrupt. And they find that they cannot cover their losses through increasing taxes. And so they're turning to the federal government. And you know what? Those guys in Washington are perfectly happy to create the money out of nothing. It doesn't cost them anything. They just go to the Federal Reserve and a little teamwork kicks in there and they create these billions or trillions of dollars taken from the American people through inflation, which is, we haven't seen anything yet, but it's coming because of this. And they'll give it to the states and to the cities. And meanwhile, there will be strings attached. And from that point forward, any idea of states in particular, you know, flexing their muscle and say, no, we're going to nullify this act from the federal government, or we're going to stand against the federal government on this issue and that issue because we are sovereign states according to the Constitution and all that sort of thing, which is true, becoming less so with each passing year, as the states have already accepted tremendous amounts of money from the federal government, and those have carried a lot of conditions with them. But once the federal government starts to bail out the states in toto, in terms of billions of dollars, I think that's pretty much the end of the line of the old concept of states' rights. Now we've taken that final step to where we have just one massive central government, pretty much on the Soviet model.
I want to go forward, and you've updated one of your last chapters in the book, and you call it the doomsday mechanism.